The question is, was the acceptance of the Torah coerced? And if it was, what does that mean for our time? Essentially, what I want to talk about today is Kafa Alim Hal Kigigit, when Hashem put the mountain over top of our heads and said, if you accept the Torah, good. There shall be your grave. So I want to dive into the Talmud here. And the goal of this class is not only to understand what it means for the Torah to be coerced. That's going to be one aspect of it. And I'm going to try to understand specifically the Maharal's point of view, because that's what's relevant to this class, even though there are many explanations for that. And I want to take that today to what Jewish education and Torah education means today and how that all started from Har Sinai. So let's get straight into it. As you can see, I'm sharing my screen. If you can see it, the Talmud in Masechet Shabbat. The Talmud in Masechet Shabbat says as follows. There is a pasuk in the context of Matan Torah, receiving the Torah, the 19th chapter of Shemot, of Exodus. And it says as follows, Vayitzvu betachtit ha'har. They stood at the bottom of the mountain. Now, what does the bottom of the mountain mean? Really, it should have been liraglei ha'har, at the foot of the mountain, or liad ha'har, next to the mountain. Literally underneath the mountain, and you can discuss if as far as Hebrew syntax, betachtit could mean at the foot of the mountain as well, but it's a very uncommon way of saying that, even in the Torah, in the bottom of the mountain. So the Talmud takes the liberty of saying the following. Amar Rav Avdimi Bar Chama, Bar Chasa, he says the following, Hashem essentially took the mountain, all of Har Sinai, like a bucket over their head, and he was going to crush them. He says, he put it over his head, hovering over their head, Har Sinai. Amar lehem, he said to them, Im atem mekabelim haTorah, if you accept the Torah, mutav, that's good. V'im lav, but if not, sham tekvuatchem, there will be your grave. It goes on to draw parallels between the Torah acceptance at Matan Torah, the Torah acceptance of Purim, Achashverosh. It's a slightly different class, but it's important to note that is the accepting the Torah in Purim out of love is the closing of the circle of accepting the Torah out of fear in Har Sinai. And that is essentially how the Talmud frames it. It continues by talking about the concept of Torah learning, and saying as follows, what does it say that it's written in Bereshit Aleph, at the end of the first chapter, the beginning of the second chapter of Bereshit, God closes down the sixth day of creation. It says, Vayer Vayvoker Yom Hashishi. So you know that all the days, it says, Yom Echad, Yom Sheni, Yom Shlishi, it doesn't say the first day, the second day. It just says day one, day two, second, third, fourth, fifth. When it gets to the sixth, it doesn't say day six. It says the sixth day with the hey, which is a prefix for the word the, emphasizing a very specific day. And the Talmud rightly points out, what is this hey yetera lamali? Why do I have this excess letter of hey? The answer is Melamed Sheitna Kadosh Baruch Hu Imaseh Bereshit. Hashem made a condition with the world, with the creation of the world, or Maaseh Bereshit. And Hashem says as follows: Im Israel mekablim haTorah, if Israel receives the Torah, atem mitkaimim, you, meaning the world, the creation, will keep existing. V'im lav, but if Israel doesn't receive the Torah, I'm going to start, go back all the way to square one, to tohu vavohu, to complete and utter chaos. So we have a couple of questions here, mainly three. One, why is the world effectively pending Israel's acceptance of the Torah? That's how the sugya ends. Two, what does it mean that Israel were coerced? Was there an actual mountain lifted over their heads? Or was it something else? What is it? And three, why does it say, Shamtek Vuatchem? If you really want to get technical, and this is going to be a very important point. If you're going to get technical, the Talmud should have said as follows. We stood at the bottom of the mountain, and it teaches us that Hashem coerced them by putting the mountain over their heads. It says, if you receive the Torah, good. And if not, here, under the mountain, will be your grave. But ladies and gentlemen, that is not what the Talmud says. The Talmud says, Sham, there will be your grave. So imagine pointing a gun at somebody, God forbid, and saying, I want you to do this. And if not, there, you're going to have a consequence. And the person would turn around and say, what do you mean there? Are you going to shoot me or not? This whole thing is really, really bizarre. There's many interpretations, many commentaries on what the coercion actually is. One of the popular opinions is that they accepted the Torah because they already said, as we know, Naseh v'nishma, we will understand. We accept the Torah. They've already said that not once, but twice. Before this, however, they didn't accept the punishment. Or maybe they accepted it as a collective, but not as an individual obligation. Those are two very common interpretations, one by the Rif, one by, I believe, Rashi. But I want to get into the Maharal. The Maharal says something very, very interesting here in this source sheet. In this source sheet, I decided not to put together a source sheet because Michael Schultz put it together very, very well in Sefaria. But I'm going to take what the sources he put together and take it in a very different direction. So here, as you can see on your screen, is the Maharal from Gur Aryeh. And he talks about this passage of Talmud. And he says as follows, and I'll read in the English. I'm not comfortable with the explanation that negates all Israel's merits of proceeding, we will do to we will hear, to go back from the great merit which lasts generations. Maybe Tosfot is reasonable that out of fear, they could have gone back on it. I mean, that's what Tosfot says, that effectively, if you only have acceptance, but you don't have fear, then you can go back on it. So what Tosfot is saying, which Maharal brings, it's not Maharal's commentary, but he brings the Tosfot, Baalei Tosfot's commentary on this sugya. And Tosfot say as follows, you can have an understanding with somebody, you can love that person and you can have a handshake and agree with them and saying, okay, we're going to go into a deal together. And that's great if you're in the diamond industry in Switzerland back in the days, whereas Mazel Uvrocha, and they closed tens of millions of dollars deals in diamond sales on a handshake and reputation only. That is very rare. For all other cases, I strongly recommend using a contract. Even rabbis, even though people, well, for the most part, trust their rabbis in the communities. Rabbis have contracts with the communities. Money's involved. There's employment issues. You always want to have also a deterrent. You want to know that you're going to hit your measurables. You're going to succeed. You're going to do your job description, and you're paid for your job description. And you need that deterrent of a contract that is binding. And that's effectively what was created here, according to the Tosfot. Because if you accept it on your own will, that as a volunteer, then you can leave it. That's why in Jewish communities all over the world, even if it's not a great financial need, which it usually is, but you want people to pay some kind of membership or contribution to the community so that they won't think that they're getting everything for free. They've actually earned it. They own part of it. And once you pay into it, you have some kind of something that bonds you to it. And you can't just walk away like any volunteer. That's what Tosfot says. And he says, okay, that's an explanation. However, he points out the word sham tekvuatchem, there will be your grave. Where is there? They're under the mountain. Where is there? And imagine the scenario that you literally have about 3 million people standing underneath the mountain, and a mountain's hovering over their heads, and you have to accept the Torah. You really don't have a choice at that point. It is a form of coercion because your life's on the line. But then you hear a voice saying, there will be your grave. Where's there? So the Maharal says, Kiatorai echrechit lekabla. What is there? There is not this generation. It's future generations. It's an incredibly important point. So let it sink in for a little bit. Hashem is saying, I'm going to coerce you to receiving the Torah, not because I question it, your loyalty. Hashem's not questioning their loyalty, although he could have, because they definitely tested Hashem for 40 straight years and then for many years afterwards. But he's not questioning their loyalty. He knows they're going to accept the Torah. He's making a point. He's giving them a message. The message is Torah is vital for your existence. That's the message. In the words of the Maharal, Ki ha-Torah hechrechit lekabla. The Torah is, and I'll highlight this here for you, the Torah is incredibly important and essential to receive. If you don't receive the Torah, you won't have anything else. Goes back to the first source. If you think about the first source, the world's existence is pending for 2,000 years, pending Israel receiving the Torah. So essentially, it was a trial. Let's see how this works. It's like investing, Hashem invested in the world. And like any startup or business you invest in, you want it to come into fruition. In the initial stages, it looks great. There's unbelievable growth, amazing stories, but you want to see if there's going to be longevity. This business is going to thrive over time. And the world can only thrive over time if there's Torah. And there's many reasons for that. But I want to today focus on what that means for the Jewish people specifically. Back to me. I want to tell you a story. It's a very famous story. It's a story of Rabbi Akiva, the fish, and the fox. Oops, that's better. Rabbi Akiva, the fish, and the fox. So Rabbi Akiva was caught with a person named Papos Ben Yehuda. It's a very famous story. Many kids know it. So I'll cut to the chase. Papos Ben Yehuda was possibly a Roman informant, most likely. And he came to Rabbi Akiva and he said, what are you doing? Why are you learning Torah? If you're learning Torah, you might die because the Romans could catch you for it and will ultimately kill you. And Rabbi Akiva said to Papos, well, let me give you the following analogy. And he gives him an analogy of a fox that's trying to lure the fish out of the water, saying you'll be safe from the nets if you come out to the dry land. Come with me. And the fish say, well, there may be nets in here, but if we're out of land, for sure we'll die. And Rabbi Akiva says, if we're out of the sphere of Torah, if we're out of the sea of our river, then we will for sure die as a nation, as a collective, as a people. And I'd rather die doing that than for sure dying, leaving Torah. So even if the Romans catch me, they're catching me when I'm in my place of life. They catch you, Papos. They'll catch you when you're not learning Torah. And then what have you earned? And that's how the Talmud ends, where that story ends. That Ashrecha Rabbi Akiva, shenitpas al yedei Torah, he's praised for being caught, for learning Torah. He's being caught by continuing life. And Papos was caught for Devarim Batilim, for other things that are outside of Torah. And he was caught for nothing. So what did he fight for? What did he die for? Rabbi Akiva died to preserve Torah Judaism. And the Rambam takes it even a step further. Maimonides in his Hilchot Talmud Torah say, Ein lecha mitzvah b'chol mitzvot kulan shehi shkula keneged Talmud Torah. Ela Talmud Torah keneged kol ha-mitzvot kulan. That the weight of Talmud Torah has the same spiritual weight as all the other mitzvot. Without Torah learning, we have nothing. We literally have nothing. But how far does this go? How far does this go? That without the Torah, we have nothing. Think of the great Torah educators. Think of the great rabbis of the time, of our times, and which rabbis were praised for what things. There are rabbis who give great drashot. There are rabbis who were political leaders as well, like Rabbi Akiva. There are spiritual leaders that help teach more people Torah. And not only do they help teach more people Torah, but also there is a very, very special rabbi called Yeshua ben Gamla. And Yeshua ben Gamla in the Talmud in Masechet Baba Batra, And I'm going to share my screen again. It says as follows. Damarav Yudah Marav, Bram Zachul Oto Aish Latov. That man is and his name is Yoshua ben Gamla. Without him, Nishtakach Torah Mi'Israel, the Torah would have been forgotten from Israel. Why? Shebitchila Mishesh Lo Av Melamdo Torah Mishen Lo Av Haya Lamed Torah. Essentially, people would be homeschooled, learn at home. But he says that you have to learn, essentially people have to learn in Yerushalayim, and it evolved to the fact that Yatsa Ad Sheben by Yeshua Ben Gamla, Vetiken, Yeshua Ben Gamla established that what we call in Israel, Chok Chinuch Chova, or that there's a law of education, which exists where I am in New Zealand and in other places for general education, that a kid must go to school, must be in an educational structure, environment for the first X amount of years of their life. Every country is different. Usually it's up to year 10 or grade 10. And according to Yeshua Ben Gamla, you have to learn at the very least when you're 6 or 7 years old. If you can't teach them at home, you have to learn Torah with a melamed tinokot, with effectively a school teacher. And he invested in Jewish schools. It's a really, really important takana. And he says, without him, then the entire Torah would have been lost. It's something that has redefined Judaism. Jewish education effectively has redefined Judaism. And the most important thing for any community to invest in is, in fact, Jewish education. The sad part is that this does not always happen. And I've been looking up, I'm in a small Jewish community here in Wellington, and I know that one of the most important things that we have to do here is have good, high quality Jewish education. Even though we don't have a school here, we have our once a week program, we have other programs, and we're trying to actually teach Torah throughout the country of New Zealand to Jewish families around the country on Zoom or otherwise, or even going and visiting them, because that is the most important thing, that important element of any Jewish community. The foundation of Jewish continuity lies in our education. That's the message that Hashem gave them under Har Sinai. The coercion, one could say, was not actually a mountain. The coercion itself was that, how are you going to deny God? How is a nation of 3 million people who just left Egypt, possibly leaving 12 million people behind in their wake, who were still idolaters, and seeing the 10 makot, seeing the 10 plagues, seeing the splitting of the Red Sea, seeing the manna fall in the desert, seeing all the miracles, the open miracles, the bitter water turned to sweet water, the feeding of Amalek by Yehoshua. You see all these things. How can you deny God? That was the coercion. There were no atheists in the desert. When Hashem says, I'm giving you my Torah, everyone believed it was God's Torah. You didn't really have a choice. And so Hashem is saying that I will tell you what your choice is. Your choice is that in the future, you will have a choice to learn Torah or not. However, let's see. However, the... One minute. However, in the future, you will not have that choice. In the future, what's going to define the Jewish continuity is going to be your Jewish education. And that's why, listen, there are communities, to be honest, that make mistakes. There's communities, and I've seen this time and time again, without mentioning, of course, specific communities. They'll take half of their fund, invest it in a building, half of their fund, invest it in other projects, and then the community won't be together. People will leave Judaism. People won't have a Jewish identity because they've invested in things other than Jewish education, but they haven't prioritized Jewish education well enough. And so the message this Shavuot is not only on a micro level, but also on a macro level, we have to invest in Jewish education. And hopefully everyone will have a Chag Sameach. Thank you very much.